this area of Madagascar where people said there might still be this tortoise, this Anganuka tortoise might still occur. People have said it was maybe extinct. Anyway, we found a few of them, and the end of the story is at the bottom there. We rediscovered it in April of 71. Just a few days ago, I got an email from Madagascar saying they're functionally extinct in the wild. Okay, I'll explain why. So we went there, we did some research on the tortoises, we found some. We got some from villages where they were kept as pets, took them to the Honolulu Zoo, really messed with them. Electro-ejaculation, all kinds of stuff, you don't want to know, okay? And yeah, we figured out how to hatch these little guys, okay? Then I wrote a recovery plan for the IUCN on how to save this tortoise. In situ and ex situ. In situ conservation, ex situ captive breeding to build up and head start populations for reintroduction. So we set up a facility in Madagascar. It's been running. They've got hundreds of tortoises in this facility. The problem is, if they put one outside on the ground somewhere, oh, hey, there's a gold bar. Pick it up. It's in the trade. Okay? This is the Bangkok airport. These are these Anganuks coming in. You can get $50,000 for one of these tortoises. Okay? Annual income in Madagascar in the rural area is like $100 or $200 a year, okay? This stuff is worth, these silly tortoises are worth more per pound than rhino horn, okay? And the rarer they get, the more valuable they are. So when I go to an IUCN red listing meeting and say, well, we should raise that from vulnerable to endangered, or no, maybe endangered to critically endangered. The day after we do that, you go to Jakarta or Bangkok, the price is crossed out. Now, critically endangered. So we're doing a lot of help on smuggling. Anyway, so this tortoise is now, I've done a lot of work on this tortoise, probably got promoted to associate professor on papers I was publishing on this tortoise. But now it's functionally extinct in the wild. That was, we knew that was coming because there's just no way we could maybe hire a few people to guard a rhino, but these silly tortoises stumbling around in the swamp somewhere, it's hard. So, but we have a lot in captivity, and so now the focus will be on ex situ conservation, breeding up captive assurance colonies in captivity for ultimate reintroduction. The interesting thing is most of you know the difference between in situ and ex situ. We came up with a new term called non situ. These are animals that are somewhere. They're not in a captive breeding group. They're not in some zoo or somewhere. And they're not in the wild. They're nowhere, which means they're in private collections somewhere. There's parrots like this that are extinct in the wild and nobody has them, but somebody knows somebody that has them and so on and so forth. There's probably hundreds of these animals in Southeast Asia that are in clandestine populations. So, and they're being bred in Madagascar. We've had invasions and attacks. People have been killed trying to protect these tortoises. So it's scary, but I think, you know, you're familiar with the term redshirting? What does that mean in athletics? You get off the team for a while because of health reasons or bad grades. So we talked about redshirting these tortoises. What does that mean? Take them out of the game. Not for a year, for 100 years. You can't do that with hummingbirds, but you can do it with tortoises, okay? There's tortoises in the Honolulu Zoo that are over 100 years old, okay? You pull them out of the game. Maybe Madagascar gets it shipped together in 50 years or 100 years, and we can put them back in. So tortoises have that. We have that luxury with tortoises. And I always think I was pretty smart when I was young. I was on the Serengeti in the 1970s and loving the cheetahs and said, hey, I want to study cheetahs. Then I realized, one day I'll be old. It'll be hard to chase a cheetah. So I said, I'll stick with tortoises and then later when I'm stumbling on the so it worked. Okay? I was pretty smart back then. Okay. So here's the situation for our global plan for tortoise domination. Giant tortoises. How many giant tortoises are left in the world? One group in the Galapagos Islands, and then also on the island of El Dabra in the Indian Ocean, they have giant tortoises. Okay, that's it today. There's some pretty big tortoises on the continents, but not many, and most of those have been killed. Tortoises really had a good deal. They figured it out in the Mesozoic, and they live in their home, and they just walk around with their house, and if you bother them, they go inside until you go away, okay? That was great until humans showed up. And they look looked at the tortoise and I said, that's not a shell, that's a cooking pot. Just flip it over in the fire, okay? And so tortoises have done very poorly since humans arrived, okay? Now there's about 40 other species of tortoises in the world. Many of them in Southern Africa. I'm working in Southern Africa right now. There's about 40 other species. Some are little teeny guys, 3 inches long. Some are pretty big, 200 pounds. But the two giant tortoises and all these other tortoises are what's left in the world today of tortoise biodiversity. Some of these tortoises are ecosystem engineers, particularly the big ones. And others are keystone species because they do interesting things, like the desert tortoise in California digs a burrow. The gopher tortoise in Florida digs a burrow. And those burrows have lots of commensal organisms that hang out, and that burrow provides really interesting synergism for other species. They turn over the soil, so they're in the desert tortoises are really important. Others of these are probably useless. But they're just little guys, little rocks with legs wandering around somewhere, okay? These red guys are the extinct tortoises. Most of them extinct in the Pleistocene and Holocene and Anthropocene, okay? These are recent extinctions, okay? We think of the Galapagos as the hotbed of tortoise diversity, giant tortoise diversity. There are actually much greater diversity in the Caribbean. All the Caribbean islands had giant tortoises, different kinds of tortoises, and so on. And some of them may have survived even up into post-Columbus times. There's a few giant tortoise in the Turks and Caicos fossils that are half fossils, sub-fossils, that are associated with pirate artifacts. So who knows? Giant tortoises in the Indian Ocean, I showed you in Madagascar. A lot of extinct tortoises, mostly all because of human impact. We'll come back to this area later, the South Pacific. Coevolution. Tortoises on islands, or any big herbivore, will be an important engineer in terms of vegetation, ecosystem development. I was young once. This is in the Galapagos, sometime in the early 70s. There's some islands in the Galapagos that never had tortoises. They're too small or too remote. There, the cactuses are recumbent, normal, natural, what I'm supposed to be, Oclintia cactus, okay? On the islands with tortoises, they turn into trees. And the tortoises are getting longer necks, sort of like giraffes trying to reach the paths. So really strong coevolution of plants and animals in areas where they are the dominant herbivore. Okay. Aldabra, this big atoll in the Indian Ocean near Madagascar. The tortoises are living on a flat atoll, not very complicated, but they create a tortoise turf, just a mowed lawn situation, and they fight for shade. There's about 100,000 tortoises on this atoll. It's about 20 miles long. Now, they went almost to zero as well because it's hard to land on this island, so it's other plant adaptations to browsing that show up in these islands, such as heterophylly, divaricating structure of plants and so on, indicate in some islands that don't have any big herbivores right now that there must have been something there earlier, and we find the fossils to substantiate that the vegetation and evolution of the plants was at least partially controlled by these mesoherbivores, okay? Sea dispersal, okay? Where shall I take this pandanus? Really important, particularly in wet forest areas. And interestingly enough, recent studies, these are so-called yellowfoot tortoises in the Amazon. They can get pretty big, but mostly they're kind of small, about this big. Studies in the Amazon recently have shown that these are one of the major seed dispersals in the Amazon, seed dispersers in the Amazon. What would be the first thing you think about seed disperser in a tropical rainforest like the Amazon? What do you think about birds? Monkeys, birds, and so on. Well, it turns out parrots eat all the seeds and chew them up. The monkeys are, let's say they pass material very quickly. So they'll be eating fruit in a tree and they'll be crapping at the same time, okay? Which means the seeds are under the same tree, right? Okay, I mean, I'm exaggerating, but you get the idea. The tortoises, because they're, I don't want to say they're not too bright, but they just randomly wander around the forest doing stuff, and they have gut retention of 1 to 2 weeks, okay? Very different from the warm-blooded critters, okay? So it turns out studies have shown these guys are like super important, but they're being wiped out in the Amazon for the pet trade, or going to China for food or whatever, okay? Now the IUCN has all kind of guidelines for translocation, supplementation, reintroduction, introduction. What we're talking about here is not on their list, okay? Like putting alien stuff somewhere where it doesn't belong. Okay, they don't have a category for that, okay? But there's good examples of actual implementation. In the Galapagos, there were islands that had been, the vegetation had been wiped out by goats or rats or some alien species, and the tortoises were down on this island of Hood or Espanola. They were down to 15 tortoises about 50 years ago. They moved them all to another island, kept them in captivity, built a little house, like a chicken house for 12 baby tortoises, and they raised these things, the right species for the right island. They replaced them, they got rid of the goats, and now there's thousands of tortoises left. This was just a reintroduction, managed conservation effort that's been very successful. There's no people living on the island. There's a lot of things that make it easier than in some other situations. And with the crazy Kiwi New Zealanders running amok, even reducing, getting rats off the big islands, it's amazing. There's a couple of islands there they've been able to make rat-free, where rats were the predator on the apes. And so, you know, standard, that tortoise was there, got wiped out, but we caught, had some, we put them back. Acceptable kind of reintroduction. Now, what about the mascarenes? That's this group of islands. Aldabra is here. This is a group of islands, including Mauritius, La Reunion, and Rodrigues, and a few other smaller islands in the Indian Ocean. These all had giant tortoise populations. The interesting thing here, we can't blame the Aboriginal populations for wiping out these tortoises. The Europeans get credit, okay? These islands were actually discovered by the Europeans. There were no human beings there when they showed up. We talk about the discoveries of Captain Cook, whatever, most places discovered already, people were already there, okay? But these islands were truly discovered by the Europeans. So what did they find? The megafauna hadn't been, the cream on top of the ecosystem that hadn't been swept off. And they found giant tortoises, pretty interesting birds, flightless parrots, all kinds of stuff, okay? When, beginning about the 16th century, 17th century, 18th century, they wiped out all the giant tortoises. All extinct by the middle of the 19th century. By 1840, they were gone on all these islands, okay? Most of them were gone a century or two before, because they were good food, okay? So, these guys emerged and said, we want some tortoises back in our ecosystem. Well, sorry, they're gone. You had an endemic genus of tortoise, not only endemic species. We don't have any more tortoises. Well, what about Aldabra? Can we use those? They're giant tortoises. So, well, okay, let's try it. Okay? But they tried it on a little offshore island here, Isla Jerez, the egret islands here. And honoring the tortoise that used to be here, they made a bronze model of the native tortoise, which was extinct. There's a couple of museums. And then they brought in the Aldabra tortoises and said, okay, you guys, take over. Okay? And on this island, there were ebony trees that hadn't been very successful in reproducing for a century or two and were kind of endangered in the shrinking population. The tortoises love to eat the seeds of the ebony and pass those seeds. The seeds germinated passing the gut of these tortoises. In fact, this is the control where the seeds didn't go through the gut, and this is the germination percentage for gut pass tortoise seeds of this native plant. So the tortoise, it's not rocket science. There, these things co-evolved and so on and so forth. So alien tortoise probably doing not a perfect thing in terms of a completely natural ecosystem, but creating a system that's closer to what was there than you could get by just saying, sorry, no tortoise. So we put in the wrong tortoise, okay? Sorry, okay? So the island, this is looking at the island. this is the new edition of ebony seedlings coming up since tortoise reproduction. There's a guy in Mauritius who just breeds giant tortoises. They breed real easy. The problem is they get killed real easy too, okay? I mean, in terms of eating and so on. He's breeding hundreds of these monsters, okay? You can buy them right now if you go to kingsnake.com. You can buy these baby tortoises for $1,000, $1,500 here in the United States, okay? He's selling them in the pet market, okay? But he's also releasing them in vast numbers. And the interesting thing that relates to Hawaii, one of the islands I was talking about, Mauritius here, Rodrigues is a smaller island, only about 8 miles long. These are all volcanic islands of different ages. La Reunion still has an active volcano. This little island was uninhabited, discovered in the 16th century, and nobody lived there, but it was full of tortoises. The first visitor said you could walk across the island by hopping on the back of one tortoise to another, possibly a slight exaggeration. But one of the last places to have tortoises, had them up until about 1800, 1810. By that time, they wiped out all the tortoises there, and those people loved eating tortoises, so they were just having shipments of tortoises coming in from Rodrigues. Meanwhile, people moved to Rodrigues and started farming, and from a few hundred people, mostly of Malagasy origin, on that island, it's now 30 or 40,000 people on this little island, and most of them are rural farmers. The place is just completely devastated. But there's some caves there. David Burney has done the cave work on Kauai, and I have worked a little bit on tortoise-related issues. He's done some work there to find out what was there before, and the giant tortoises were there in the caves. You can find the remains of the giant tortoises. The island is pretty well trashed, okay? But this guy that's breeding all these tortoises has put them back on the island. One of the things he noticed after he put tortoises back on the island, there were some weeds on this island, lots of weeds from all over the world, Aulicoa and all kinds of stuff. There were also three Hawaiian plants there, just as weeds. I mean, how the hell did they get there? Okay, well, weeds get everywhere, okay? And he noticed the tortoises weren't eating these weeds, but they were eating other weeds. Now that seems weird because we assume that the Hawaiian plants are somehow not adapted to browsing and grazing, don't have spines, don't have whatever. But maybe they have more subtle defenses. Maybe defenses against beaks rather than teeth. Okay? I don't know. We'll talk about that in a minute. Anyway, he found these plants here, and when he started his restoration, he planted hundreds of thousands of native trees, brought in thousands of tortoises. It's a big reserve there. He noted that they loved eating most weeds, a lot of plants, even native plants, whatever, but they were staying away from some nice Hawaiian plants. Deal there. Now, you say, well, yeah, you make it sound nice, just introduce some tortoises somewhere. But one of the main criticisms of assisted colonization or alien species, proxy species introduction is what happens if they go bad? Okay? What if they do bad things? Okay? Like the mongoose was supposed to do what? Eat rats and sugar cane. Okay? Little issue of diurnal versus nocturnal, but they did bad things. But now I'm worried about the mongoose. I'm not worried, I'm worried for the mongoose, because what am I seeing around Hilo now a lot? Chickens. You never used to see chickens running around in Hilo. So what are the mongoose doing? They're supposed to eat all those guys. Are they dying off? What's happening to the mongoose? Are the chickens getting meaner? I don't know what's happening, but I'm seeing chickens all over this island, up on the Saddle Road in Kona. It's like Kauai. When you go to Kauai, you see chickens everywhere because they don't have mongoose. Okay? Why don't they have mongoose? Because in 1880, when they delivered the mongooses from Jamaica, although they were originally from India, they were in Honolulu, they divided them into groups, sent them to each island, had sugar cane, and the guy on the dock at Lake Uli or wherever it is, saw this cage full and asked the guy, what's going on? He said, oh, we're gonna turn these loose, they're gonna get the rats and the sugar cane. I said, I don't think so. He just kicked it off the dock. Okay? And he put a statue to that guy. Anyway, what are the mongoose doing? Somebody needs to study the damn chickens and mongoose. I don't know what's going on. Chickens are taking over. Okay? I think that's a good thing. Okay? But the point I'm making here, tortoises are are really easy to get rid of. How do we know that? Because we've exterminated them all over the world. So it's not like mosquitoes or mongoose where it might be hard to get rid of them. We know we can wipe these guys out in no time if they turn out to be misbehaving. Okay? So that's a plus for tortoises. Well, not for the individual tortoise that blows away. But anyway, you probably don't even need a scope. Okay, so for years I've been talking about, let's bring tortoises to Hawaii. You say you're crazy just because you like tortoises here. Well, you can buy them at Petco, okay? You can buy tortoises. In fact, I run a garbage truck on Maui. It goes around and picks up big tortoises that people bought when they were little and thought they would just be little tortoises, and now they're 200 pounds in the backyard, okay? And they want to get rid of them. So we take them to the Tortoise Rescue Center on Hawaii, okay? Now, this is the Moanalo. Native Hawaiian goose, or actually it's a dabbling duck that evolved into a big flightless critter. Went extinct shortly after the Polynesians arrived here. No reflection on the Polynesians. You eat stuff that's easy to get. Okay, there's no food stamps, okay? They only had this guy. When the Polynesians first arrived in New Zealand, they had 1,000-pound birds. You know, one drumstick could feed a family of 20, okay? This is called the scientific name, the tortoise beak bird. Okay? So if there was a tortoise beak bird here, okay, let's put another tortoise beak bird back. Oops, can't find any. Okay? There's a few geese that might do something. And actually, I've got a place up in Koloko behind the mountains of Kona, and the pheasants and the turkeys that are running around there, they're probably doing something good in relation to seed dispersal that these birds might have done in the past. They may be doing bad things, I don't know. But, so I said, well, let's bring some tortoises in. And everybody said, no, you're crazy. How can you consider these as proxies or cognates? Impossible. I said, wait a minute. This guy can reach about this high off the ground. That's where the tortoise can reach. So browse height is okay. Yeah, but this is 300 or 400 pounds, and this is like 30 or 40 pounds. I said, yes, but one is warm-blooded, one is cold-blooded, very different metabolic rates, okay? Anyway, they still after me. So this is the tortoise. This is the tortoise-billed bird. Here's a shot of its brain. This is the only Moanalo I go and visit. This is an Honolulu Zoo, okay? The kids love it. They come up and they get pictures next to it and so on and so forth. But it gives a good lesson on extinction, okay? Okay, we can't find one of these guys. So what do we do in Hawaii? We introduce other proxies, herbivores. We need more herbivores. The Europeans, when they got here, they introduced herbivores, not because they loved the Polynesians, but because, hey, when we come back next time, we want some goat meat or some sheep or some horses or cows or whatever. And, of course, even the Polynesians bought a few things, but they didn't have much in Tahiti or Marquesas. They could bring maybe rats or dogs, a chicken, pig, so on. But Europeans could bring things from anywhere in the world, all right? So the problem with goats is they chew up a lot of food. They don't pass the seeds the same way as a tortoise does. And their browse height is very uncontrollable, okay? So not a good cognate, not a good proxy for the extinct Moanalo, okay? Now people have brought deer here by helicopter a couple years ago, okay? Deers are dangerous, okay? Over 150 people every year are killed in deer car accidents in the mainland, okay? I don't know if anybody's been, there's lots of deer on Molokai, on Maui, on some on Hawaii. But why would you introduce something that could kill small children? That would be crazy, okay? When they were bringing deer to the Big Island secretly a few years ago, and I think they've shot most of them or all of them down south, they were backhauling mouflon to Maui. They're gonna fly a secret boat out, they might as well haul both ways. So they don't know if there's any mouflon on, we have mouflon on this island, intentionally introduced in the 50s, hybridized with a feral sheep and produce a trophy animal. They never talked about it, okay? So why would you introduce these dangerous creatures? Because you can introduce tortoises. They don't kill anybody. Okay? But still, people laughed at me as you are now. So, what have we done in Hawaii? Well, on the island of Makuhai Cave on Kauai is where David Burney has done this incredible reconstruction from cave sedimentary deposits. It's got about 10,000 years. He finds all the plants, 19th century coins near the top, just an incredible array. Right through the Polynesian period, down into the pre-human period. He's got all the plants and all the animals that are running around there. And right next door, and there's bones of the Moanalu there, and some of their relatives. They're not just one big bird, there were several. This is the existing Meimei, but there are a bunch of different sized ones. This is the more tortoise-beaked one. This is the bigger one that was on this island. Right next to that cave reserve is a bunch of old sugarcane plantation land that was given to the cave reserve to restore the native forest. How do you restore the native forest? Well, you know what was growing there because it's there in the column, okay? Problem? Weeds, right? Where you clear a little area right next to it, it's all halicola or some invasive plant, okay? So it's a continuous fight against alien weeds. So you've got people out there, volunteers out there digging weeds, bulldozing weeds, spraying weeds, doing everything to control weeds. Intensive and in some cases not very green. You're going to use pesticides, herbicides, and so on. So we said, let's do it like they do in Rodriguez, okay? So we brought in the tortoises. Where do we get the tortoises? From backyard pets here in Hawaii that people said, my kid grew up and went away to college. I got this giant tortoise in my backyard. They're called sulcata from North Africa. And there's no warning on the label at Petco when you buy it. This cute little tortoise, 3 inches long, is going to weigh 200 pounds and be this big, okay? And they're mean when they get big. They're not a happy tortoise, okay? Males will kill one another for a female. Well, maybe we're sort of like that, I don't know. But anyway, they're mean and they dig. They're burrowing tortoises. They burrow under houses, under foundations, through fences. We call them in Southern California, where there's many thousands of these things, we call them suburban time bombs. And they grow up, they just cause all kinds of problems. So what do people do? They take them out and release them on the desert in California, okay? So anyway, we get these for free. The problem is they're not the best tortoise to manage in a herd because the males fight and they're just kind of bad news tortoises. And there are other big, the bigger, like the Aldabra and the Glaucus, they're kind of well-behaved, gentle, and they're big, they don't take any crap, they just walk around slowly. These guys just want to fight all the time. Okay. They'll even attack you. Sometimes we go somewhere, one of these will sneak up behind and just ram you in the leg, a 200-pound tortoise. I mean, I have to kill, but it's dangerous. The sneak of tortoises is potentially dangerous, okay? But they don't kill children, okay? So we're not letting these things run around wild. They're fenced in and so on and so forth. And studies have been done there of what they're eating, like here, a little controlled exposure, enclosure, what are they eating? But they're fighting, they're fooling around. We did feeding trials. What plants were they eating, not eating? We do feeding trials of natives and aliens, repeated feeding trials. And you give them all kinds of food, and then you follow them around in the wild and see what they're eating outside. Typically, they're eating alien species and not native species, even though we're planting lots of native species in there. So, I'm not saying they're not any native species, but they're weed controlling more than anything else, okay, which is good. We're also looked at them ingesting native plant seeds and looking at their germination rate and so on. They seem to be helpful. Now, they may also be germinating alien species as well, but they seem to be pretty good at germinating some of the native species. We also collected the dung and looked at the soil in areas where the tortoises were living versus areas where there weren't any tortoises, and doing some studies and found that fairly significant increase in nitrogen, improvement of the soil in those areas because they're recycling nutrients into the soil, like fertilizer, okay? So that's a plus. Well, you could say it might be a plus for alien species as well, but they're eating more of the alien species. So ultimately it's a win-lose thing where the natives seem to be gaining ground. Okay, so that's what we're doing in Hawaii. And if you have have a giant tortoise, when you get rid of it, just call me, pick it up. Okay? Going back to this extinction map, we talked about the Mascarene Islands here, and we didn't say anything about Australia. Well, in Australia and the South Pacific, there's a whole different kind of tortoise until very recently. A horned tortoise. It looked like some weird Mesozoic creature, which it was. Okay? They were part of Gondwana land, but long extinct in South America. But they were the dominant tortoises in these areas. Some of them got up to 7 or 8 feet in shell length. This is 3 to 4 times bigger than a Galapagos tortoise. These were huge tortoises. Okay? Not all the species got that big. Recently, just a few years ago, the question always is with these Pleistocene extinctions, was it caused by man or climate change or some other asteroid or whatever? Well, we confirmed in Vanuatu, not me, but White and et al., they found, what's the early Pacific settlers called? What people are they? Lapita, okay? The Lapita people, because of their pottery. They were the first Polynesian settlers into the Pacific and into Melanesia and so on. Anyway, 2,800-year Lapita site in Vanuatu, the New Hebrides. Close mixing of these giant tortoise bones, clearly cut up and so on, with human artifacts. So they took these guys out. I mean, everybody assumed they took them out. It's a proof, absolutely. Okay? And they were taken out in Australia maybe 40, 50,000 years ago because the Aborigines arrived there way before the Pacific Islanders were settled. So these giant tortoises were disappearing when humans showed up. We're talking about Vanuatu here. Giant tortoises in New Caledonia, all over Australia, New Guinea, not much further out into the Pacific. Fiji had giant tortoises. Tonga had giant iguanas, but that's a whole other situation. Anyway, on this island of on one of the islands here, they found this human archaeological site with tortoise bones. Today, if you go there, there's still some beautiful forest in the Vanuatu. What's missing? The big guy, okay? The seed disperser, the engineer who controls eating things and how things co-evolve, okay? It's gone. Now, we can't replace it. I was thinking of giving them Galapagos tortoises, but put little horn, you know, fake horns over there, you know, just so they look more natural, but no one's ever seen them anyway, so. Anyway, so this is our next target opportunity. Okay, we gotta get into the South Pacific and start producing tortoises there. We're already making headway, and we usually go to the rich, for some reason, really rich people like tortoises, which is good for me. Richard Branson, Virgin Atlantic, he has some islands, and he's introducing tortoises in the Caribbean islands that he owns, okay? And these tortoises had giant tortoises. These islands had giant tortoises just a few thousand years ago. Cuba had giant tortoises. Puerto Rico, Bahamas, Turks and Caicos, they all had giant tortoises. A bigger deal than the Galapagos is today. So we gotta find somebody to replace this one. Now, luckily, there's still a lot of tortoises around still alive. Some live in deserts. Well, you wouldn't put a desert tortoise here. But this is what these guys look like on these different islands. There are many different species. So we want to use the South American Amazonian giant tortoise, not a real giant tortoise, but it's pretty big, but it lives in a tropical rainforest. That's probably the closest we can come. Whether or not you put plastic horns on them or not, that's the closest we can come to replicating the adapted type of tortoise that might survive in New Caledonia, in Vanuatu, and so on. Okay? So we're working on that. But again, people are saying, no, don't put any alien, we got enough alien problems here, don't bring another one. But what do we say? If you don't like it, we can get rid of it. Okay? Now let's come to California. This is another failure. I talked about my first failure, the tortoise I worked on for 4 years that's now functionally extinct. My friends and I swore we'd never get involved in the desert tortoise in Southern California. It is a huge issue. I used to take measurements on desert tortoises in the 50s when I was a little kid fooling around in the desert. It's desert tortoise is a problem because everybody wants the desert now. Wind farms, solar farms, golf courses, towns, settlements, agriculture, all kinds of stuff. And the desert tortoises are in the way. The desert tortoises have been declared a threatened population in Mojave. People really don't like the desert tortoise, but have a lot of money to resolve the issue, the military, okay? Because they have tanks that drive around in the desert, they have desert warfare. We're more into desert warfare now than we are into tropical warfare, like in Vietnam. In Vietnam, we had tropical training areas in Panama, and now we have to have tropical desert training areas because that's where the oil is, okay? The desert tortoise is just in the way of all this stuff, okay? Some years ago, 30 years ago, I was in Las Vegas for a desert tortoise meeting about desert tortoise people. And they're mostly slimy, sloppy academics and, you know, tree huggers or tortoise huggers or whatever. But I noticed all these guys in shiny shoes and fancy dressed up. They were the developers, okay? Because the tortoises were stopping the development of Las Vegas. 20 or 30 years ago, Las Vegas was expanding at close to the speed of light. A new elementary school was built every 9 weeks, okay, when it was just insane, okay? But the tortoises were in the way, okay? So they had all kinds of problems. Now they're protected, how do we get rid of them? And so there's a million consultants, it's a big industry in California and Nevada, the desert tortoise industry. Scientists, academics doing studies of what's their boron uptake, what birds are eating them, what they do, all kinds of academics, and a lot of private consultants. With fiber optic cameras on little tractors that go down in the burrows and so on and so forth. Millions and millions of dollars. One of the wind farms spent like $80 million to relocate 75 tortoises. They had to find them, measure them, put them somewhere, put transmitters on them, study them, have veterinarians check them every week to see if they're healthy, all kinds of crazy stuff. And the same with development around Las Vegas. So, but here's the other problem. People love tortoises. So many people in California have a pet tortoise in their backyard that they took out of the desert. But according to state and federal law, that tortoise is biologically dead. You cannot put it back in the desert because it may have diseases, and they put it the wrong genetic, don't even start on the geneticists, okay? I'm a huge fight with geneticists, okay? Because geneticists, particularly population genetics of tortoises, the guys working in the labs doing the microbial, their DNA, they don't know anything about what these tortoises are doing, they just measure differences, okay? But sometimes the differences really make a difference, okay? So, if you have a desert tortoise in California, the first thing you have to do is register it and get a license plate, okay? You have to have a license plate on your tortoise, okay? There are about 30,000 licensed tortoises in Southern California. It's estimated that might be only half of the tortoises people keep in the backyard, probably 50,000, 60,000. Many of them were taken off the desert areas closest to LA, where there aren't any more tortoises on the desert. And therefore, the genetics of that population is in this biologically dead population. Now, these things live forever, okay? So, and you also can't breed them. You're not allowed to breed them. So. Department of Defense has all kinds of studies of desert tortoises going on. This is one at 29 Palms, the Marine Base. They are spending millions a year to breed tortoises. They take the females in just before laying. The babies are hatched and maintained here. They try to grow them up till they're more or less predator-proof, can escape coyotes and so on. Then they turn them loose. And so that's their mitigation for disturbing the desert somewhere else. But it's super expensive. Millions, they maybe produce a couple hundred tortoises every 3 years or something. So we came along and said, okay, all these tortoises, if a kid brings in a tortoise or if one gets hit on the road, it's not killed, and they save it and come back, it has to stay in captivity. You can't do anything with it. So we said, why not use these 40, 50,000 tortoises and just breed the hell out of them in captivity, okay? You say, well, they're expensive, they're all over Southern California. No, the people that have tortoises love their tortoises. They'd be happy to be participating. We'd have egg pickup areas where we could deliver the eggs, we'd take them out in the desert, bury them, and so on. The science went crazy. no, you guys are insane, get out of here. This is why. One, it's an industry. What was our goal? We wanted to produce thousands of tortoises. In fact, we called it the Massive Project. That really scared the hell out of everybody. And said, so we're going to breed 10,000 tortoises and put them back. They're saying, you're crazy. Why would you do that? No, we want, because what's the goal? Delisting of this tortoise. If we delist the tortoise, then it's not endangered anymore, and they can build swings and highways or whatever they want. So delisting was our goal. But many of the scientists and academics and consultants, delisting was out of jobs, okay? So anyway, we came up with this plan. And it had a protocol, elaborate protocol. We were abused, endlessly attacked in the literature and so on and so forth. We knew we were going to be attacked because it's, they attack one another. All the people working there are trying to get the dollars for crow research because crows are on power lines. They see the baby tortoises. The power lines right there. They wouldn't see the baby tortoises. Just a million things going on. Anyway, but the guys that really got on were the geneticists because they said, oh, wait a minute. There's all these different little metapopulations with slightly different genetics. Oh, yeah, let's do 19th century biogeography, okay? Okay. The house is burning down. Let's make sure this little population here is okay, da-da-da-da-da. Well, they're all collapsing, okay, for various reasons. So our goal was, you guys don't understand the difference between adaptation and adaptability, okay? They're saying, well, these are genetically slightly unique, they must be adapted to that situation. These tortoises, 10,000 years ago, they were up in Montana. The tortoises don't evolve, they just move around where they want to be, okay? There's lakes and rivers in this area during the Pleistocene, during the last glacier, glacial. So, I mean, they've been moving all over the place. So, yeah, they may be a little bit different. It's irrelevant. We're trying to save the species, and you're trying to make all these, how much can we spend to save this little group versus that group and create a whole bunch of stuff? So, we said, here's one of the models where there's six different subpopulations, okay? We said, these are irrelevant. Well, they didn't know that. We said, go back and read the real guides, okay? It's not about the adaptation, it's about the genetic variance, okay? Adaptability, okay? Fisher, 1930, even Darwin. Most adaptable, okay? So, we said, we're gonna make these guys adaptable. Why? Because all this crap is going on in the desert. They may be able to handle it, okay? Climate change, urbanization. Maybe they need tougher shells so they can get run over once in a while. I don't know what they need, okay? Where do we put them? That was another thing. Where are you gonna put these things? In the median strip? No, probably not, okay? On the golf course? Yeah, that could be fun. Where do we put these guys? We said there's an easy place to put the guys. Now, because of their endangered status, they have to build tortoise fences along all these giant highways running through the desert. Okay? Keep the tortoises off the highway. Okay? The problem is, by now, there are no tortoises within a mile or two of the highway, because eventually they wandered on the highway and they got killed. So we've got millions of acres of land that are now between the fence and wherever the population are, a mile in or whatever, we could release tens of thousands of these tortoises, okay? Well, again, they thought that was crazy. But we're not giving up, okay? But we're still being abused substantially, okay? So that's not a complete victory. It's sort of a failure at the moment, okay? They're not letting us do this, okay? Okay, I just wanted to end with one other thing about turtles and tortoises. Biointegration. This question about novel or natural ecosystems, we're just getting integrated with the ecosystems. Some things survive, some things don't. We like some plants and animals, we don't like others. Tortoises are easy to biointegrate. You can keep them in your backyard, save them, let them run around, whatever. But I really like what they're doing at the Maunalei Beach Hotel, okay? They've adopted the Honu, now we're talking about water turtles. They've adopted the Honu as their green contribution to environmental issues. They're branding themselves for turtle conservation, sea turtle conservation, okay? Ultimate biointegration, green sea turtles are head starting in the lobby of the okay? They get baby green sea turtles from Sea Life Park on Oahu every year, a bunch of little baby ones, and they throw them in the lobby, and they also wander on the eculine ponds outside the building itself. And they have information on traditional use and legends about the Honu, and so it's kind of cool, and people like it. And they've really mastered this thing, that you can donate money for Honu conservation when you're checking out if you want. As they get bigger, and this is, they get this big in 2 years, okay? 2 years they can more or less release them. And they've really figured this out too. 4th of July, this turtle independence day at the Mile Line, okay? They release the 2-year-old turtles, okay? Now this was taken, I don't know where, those may be Kevin Costner's kids. Kevin Costner was here when they were making Waterworld. He got hooked up with a hula dancer and got a divorce and cost him like $1 billion. But he was there 4th of July back 20 years ago, whenever they made Waterworld. And they're taking the baby turtles out to release. They link in some Hawaiian cultural traditions. I think it's kind of cool. And then they release, and people are just freaking out. They're releasing the turtles. It doesn't end there. They have turtle information stuff, and they put transmitters on the tortoises, the turtles they release. So when you go home from your vacation in Hawaii, you can follow your turtle on the web, what it's doing and where it's going, okay? So their website allows you to track, and you can track individual turtles that give you a number when you're there, and you can see what happens. It's kind of a cool integration of recreation and conservation. Okay. Bottom line is, people love turtles. Unfortunately, Asians love to eat them. China is importing a lot of turtles from the United States and all over the world. And particularly in Asia, also Japan and in North America and Europe, people want to keep their pet turtles that cost a lot of money. So there's problems there with smuggling and so on and so forth. And a lot of cultures venerate turtles for their longevity. In Asia, turtles are kind of linked with Viagra, like rhino horn, and so you can blame men primarily for turtle extinctions. It's complicated, but people love turtles. In China right now, you can buy turtle flight insurance. If you're at an airport to do an internal flight in China, you buy a baby turtle at the airport. Put it in your pocket. Fly to wherever you're going. Throw it away, give it to somebody, whatever. Why? Because turtles don't die, okay? So if you got a turtle on you, it's not gonna crash. A little turtle would die, okay? The scarier thing is you can buy turtle keychains in China where they've sealed the turtle in a plastic little bag, injected some oxygen into it, and it's a keychain. The turtle can live for 2 or 3 weeks in that little bag, but craziness, okay? The main thing that wiped me out in Madagascar was paying upwards and sometimes in excess of $100,000 for a particular rare kind of turtle tortoise. Not to eat, but for the collector's market, okay? But our clandestine plan to take over the world with tortoises is really helped by the fact that most people love tortoises, okay? And our operation on Kauai is sustained by the fact that it needs volunteers to come there on the weekends and read the plans and help out. It's bringing these adults, kids, they want to hang out with the turtles, okay? Mom, I want to go to the tortoise farm. Yeah, I got a hoe and rake and so on and so forth. So one of the benefits of tortoises is that most people like them. So beware, look around, you may see tortoises showing up, but you don't expect them. Thank you.
I know, I kind of used up my time, but that's what I do to avoid questions. But I could probably entertain a question if anybody has one or can solve for anyone. Yes?
Are there plans to release the turtles in Kauai to their area?
Not really right now. It's more or less a test. And basically, the idea is to restore more native forests on agricultural land which you would do as kind of an incremental fencing kind of situation. So there's no plan to release them widespread at the moment.
What type of individual wants to purchase a turtle for $100,000? Like, what are they doing with it?
They're probably involved in import-export or just very rich drug-related. Just rich people. You got to understand, until about 10 years ago, the only people buying these really expensive turtles were the Chinese, okay? Because they were making tons of money, buy something in Walmart. And they couldn't go out of the country. They can have banquets and so on and so forth. But, you know, if you want fancy cars, some way to exhibit your wealth. And so some people just like turtles, want the most expensive turtle. But now all over Southeast Asia, there's people in Indonesia and Thailand, which used to be the conduit of turtles going into China. There's not tons of people in Bangkok who want expensive turtles and Mercedes and a turtle. I don't know, it's crazy, okay? But the rarer they are, just like whatever you collect, artwork, stamps, whatever it is, you want the rarest of the rare, okay? And the rarer it gets. In fact, when I was in Vietnam in the 90s, I'm not in the Vietnam War, I was dodging that 20 years before. But anyway, when I was in Vietnam in the 90s, there were 5 rhinoceros left in Vietnam. They knew where they were, and they had sort of guards around them and so on. I was talking to the guy, one of the guys running this little program, said, what's going on? He said, well, the Taiwanese are the ones that controlled the rhino horn. They had vast storage of rhino horn in Taipei that they would sell and so on. He said, they put a price on these 5 rhino that's 4 or 5 times the value of the rhino itself in the trade of the rhino horn. So that doesn't seem like business sense. No, it's very good business sense. You exterminate the rhino, and then your hoard of material is more valuable. Makes perfect sense, yeah, in terms of capital. Okay? And they're gone. The last one was shot about 3 years ago. Okay? No rhinos left, and no turtles left. They've all gone to China for food. The Chinese consume. When you buy a bottle of Gatorade, what don't you expect to be in the bottle? Something from an alligator, right? Okay, it's not a hard alligator. When you buy turtle aid in drinks or powders in China, it better have turtle in it, okay? So millions of turtles are ground up into pharmaceutical products, just like tiger piss or tiger skin or tiger bones. If you want mana in China, eat a snake. Well, okay, I'll eat a snake. That'll give me some mana. What snake should I eat? What would give me the most mana? King cobra. Okay? But I don't even trust the other Chinese, so I wanted to bring the king cobra to my table, make a slit, take its beating heart out, put it in a glass full of soy sauce, and knock it back while it's still. That's mana. If you want to eat a bird, eat an eagle. If you want to eat a tortoise, eat a rare or giant tortoise or something. Okay? It's just cultural. Most of the younger people are probably not into this stuff anymore. It's just like the Japanese have trouble convincing the young kids to eat whale meat. They don't want to eat it anymore, okay? But the guys who are running the whaling fleet are saying, come on, kids, put it in the school. Eat some whale meat. Come on. Okay, anyway, other question. I think I'm finished. There's other things going on here, okay? Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for... we're going to take a short, it's going to be a 10-minute break now because we want to stay on schedule. We'll start back at 10:45, so help yourself to coffee and snacks. I'm sure Jim will be happy to talk to anybody with questions.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
just got, these are pro pictures.
He said they've got 6 months.
Oh,
yeah, things change. So,
little boy.
No, he's in the wrong spot.
Friends or sister-in-law. I hope not, because they're
and like
all
are gonna be there,
no,
Student presentations, and then we'll be starting. We'll have lunch after. We are going to have some of the leftovers from yesterday. Hopefully, we can get them fairly well reheated for lunch. So, starting our session on genomics and human and plant disease, we have Sheena.
Good morning. Thank you all for coming. I'm Shenna. I am officially a postdoc at UH Manoa, but my office is based uphill at USDA ARS. There, we do a lot of things. Mainly, we integrate classical genetic approaches, such as population genetics and Mendelian genetics, and we use those in concert with emerging genomic techniques of high-throughput genotyping and sequencing. And then we analyze all that data together using some bioinformatics. We do some validation using some gene editing. And we work with a wide variety of study systems. So our bread and butter is fritted fruit flies. So ones that are insects that are agricultural pests, they're really bad economically. And so we traditionally are in the business of killing, which is not really good for to talk about in a conservation genetic symposium. So today I'm going to be talking about the Kamehameha butterfly, which I'm sure everyone in this room knows a lot more about than I do. We've actually only been very recently looking at this and working with some people at UH Manoa. So a little bit about what I learned about the Kamehameha butterfly within the last few weeks. It's one of two native butterflies found here in Hawaii. It's commonly known as the Kulelehua. It's in the same genus, Vanessa, as admirals and painted leaves. And some previous publications mutations show that it might have originated from Asia and might be derived in its ancestral population is Vanessa indica, which is down here on the left. And here's Vanessa Kamehameha Harrison. They look very, very similar. However, some recent phylogenetic work by the Rubinoff lab at UH Halo analyzed mitochondrial data and some nuclear sequencing, or nuclear gene sequencing, shows that Vanessa Atalana, which is another admiral species, coming from North America, might actually be more closely related to it. And so that's how that shook out. So there's Atalana for comparison. And it uses, so Vanessa Kamehameha utilizes two host plants. They're two native nettles, the Mamaki and the Olona. The Mamaki is actually found in lots of places. The Olona, I think, might be a little bit more uncommon. So I didn't know this before, but it's not actually considered an endangered species. It's not on the endangered species list. But it's shown that the population is on the decline, as it's been extirpated from some parts of its native range. So due to maybe some habitat fragmentation or some disturbance or maybe some lack of its preferred host, it's no longer found in some places that it was found previously. Like all native wildlife here in Hawaii, Kamehameha butterfly is a protected species. So there's actually a project where you can go and tell this database that you've seen a Kamehameha butterfly, you take a picture, you say where you are, but you can't collect it, so you can't do that. But it's very, very pretty to see out in the wild. Unfortunately, I've actually never seen it on the wild, so I only know what it looks like based on these pictures. So one of the things that we have to do is understand it genetically and understand its population structure, so that way we can inform these management practices. If we find that when we genotype the species and it's actually clustering out to two major, or you know, let's say Hawaii, the Big Island is different from Oahu, and those are actually two different species, then we have to change your management practices accordingly. And another thing that you want to do is assess, or use these genomic tools to assess genetic variation. So a genetic variation is what a species usually uses to adapt to a changing climate. So for example, if there's climate change going on in Hawaii, you want a very genetic variable population so that way you can make those adaptations. So this is the I'd also like to acknowledge Will Haynes and Cynthia King, who are the leaders of the Kula'ulehua project, where they're assessing the geographic distribution of the Kamehameha butterfly. This work is primarily the brainchild of Will Haynes, and I'm gonna be just presenting it here for you today. So what we wanted to know is there population structure within the species Vanessa Kamehameha? So when you look at the different individuals coming from the different islands, how do they cluster genetically? Can you detect the subpopulation within the different within the range of this species? And are there species level differences? So are individuals from Kauai different enough from individuals from Maui that they're considered to be a different species? Our approach for answering these questions was to sequence a reduced representation of the genome from multiple individuals from the breadth of this population, or from the species. So by sequencing a reduced representation of the genome, when you don't get, obviously, the whole genome to analyze, but it makes it a lot easier to work with, and it's something that can be done very cheaply and very quickly. So once we do the sequencing, we can identify polymorphisms, so which parts of the genome that are different between these individuals. And then we'll do some population genetic analysis, analyzing the genotypes of these individuals to see how they segregate genetically. So a little bit about our technique for sequencing a reduced representation. The idea is that you take whole genome DNA, you cut it up using two restriction enzymes. So this library type is called the DD-RAD sequencing library. That stands for Double Digest Restriction Associated DNA Sequencing Library. So you cut up your whole genome, you end up with these little fragments then you sequence only those fragments, so you get a reduced representation of your genome, and then from those, but it's the same reduced representation for everyone in your data set. And then from there, you can call polymorphisms. So we made a library using wild collected and some lab individuals, as well as some sister taxa to Vinicetinumab. In total, we used 91 individuals. We also did some internal controls where we sequenced both the leg and then the thorax from the same individual. See, one, we can get the same type of data quality of data from a leg sample as a thorax, because I spoke with Will the other day, and he said it's very, very soul-crushing to give us a whole butterfly to crush up for a genomic sample. And if we can get the same information from a leg, then that's much preferable. Okay, so we sequenced them in an Illumina HiSeq and did single-end 100 base pair sequencing. From this, we got about 1 million reads per sample. And then when we called polymorphisms, so we identify single nucleotide polymorphisms, otherwise known as SNPs, in our data set, and then we found about 23,000. So these are where these collections came from. They came from Kauai, Oahu, Maui, Niue, and here in the Big Island. So these, let me reiterate that these are data that we received about a couple weeks ago, so this is very preliminary. We haven't done very much analysis, and it hasn't been very thorough, but of the analysis we did, I just want to show you some of that preliminary data now. So one of the first things we did was a RaxML analysis. It stands for randomized accelerated maximum likelihood. So it basically takes your samples and then puts them in a phylogenetic context. So you can use this to identify the phylogenetic relationships between the individuals that are in your data set. So we did this by taking all those 23,000 SNPs that we found and then concatenating them and analyzing them using a DNA mutation model. And since that previous study says that Vanessa abelana is actually the most closely related species, our tree was rooted using Vanessa abelana. And it shows here, so here's Vanessa abelana as the rooted species. This is a admiral, and the other species that were included were a couple of painted ladies from the mainland, Vanessa virginiensis and Vanessa cardui, and all of this Kamehameha species ended up in this one block here. So what you see here are some species level differences, so this kind of supports that there are species level differences between these different species, virginiensis, cardui, Atalanta, and Kamehameha is a good species. And this also shows you the amount of differentiation between within Vanessa Kamehameha in the context of these other species. So it's not nearly as different from each other as it is from these other species, which indicates that maybe the differences we see within Vanessa Kamehameha aren't species of species. Okay, so when you take that block and then you zoom in on it, this is what we find. One, Hawaii butterflies found on the Big Island here in Hawaii are actually more distinct and more basal compared to the rest of the sampled individuals. And Hawaii is most derived and is actually also distinct. So Oahu is kind of split a little bit, and Molokai is too, or the Maui Nui is too. But what this shows you, or what we interpret from this, is that you do see some island level differences, and so that, but there might be also some mixing going on. So these island level differences are likely due to colonization and then them being here for a long time, but there's also some butterflies that are moving between islands. So another thing that we can do with this data is analyze it for genetic differentiation. So a metric we use is pairwise FST, which is a measure of fixation, or so genetic differentiation. So within one population, you would expect a FST of zero. So you're pretty much the same genetically as someone in your population. And then when you compare your population with another, if you were different at all loci, then you would end up differentiation between individuals from Kauai and Kauai using both metrics. So the FST of 22% is actually pretty high. However, the other islands in contrast to each other aren't nearly as different. So Kauai looks different from the other islands. The other islands don't look different from each other. Kauai doesn't look that different from the other islands except for Kauai. Okay, so we want to know how this shakes out actually in like population level differences. And so when you take a subset of these, the 23,000 SNPs, and you take you take a subset of 4,000 of these SNPs, run them through a population genetic analysis software called Structure, which basically attributes determines how many different populations are in your study, and then assigns every individual to a population. What you end up is, no matter how you slice it, you end up with two likely populations: a population that's here denoted in blue coming from Hawaii, and a population that's denoted in red coming from all the other islands. Oh, so this shows the probability of being assigned to a population, and every bar is a different individual. So in summary, I think what we've shown is that, one, there's good species within the genus Vanessa, and that Vanessa Kamehameha is probably one species, but we are starting to see some population structure, so some populations within Kamehameha that are differentiating from each other. This is supported using fixation analysis, so looking at how different these populations are based on nucleotide assignment. And the DC population structure that's splitting the species into two main groups, the flies from Kauai and the flies from butterflies from Kauai and butterflies from everywhere else. So in the future, what we want to do is actually whole genome sequencing of this species, and then do an analysis an analyzer combination of parents and offspring to identify these linkage maps or chromosomes, and that would identify regions of divergence. We could see if there are genes that are under selection that are driving these species apart. Maybe there's a host association. Maybe the reason they're not doing as well is because their preferred host is declining. And if you wanted to do a release, you'd want to actually release the ones that have a preferred host that's more prevalent. And then we can actually use this data to inform management practices. Okay, thank you. I wish I had more time for this acknowledgments section because these people are very important. Nicole's the best DD Rad library maker in town. Okay, and thank you to Will and Dan for samples in this project.
Of Hawaii at Hilo in the Price Lab, where we study mostly picture wing Drosophila, but we also dabble in bats, beetles, and spiders sometimes. So today I'm going to be talking to you about my master's thesis work on plant insect association and genome evolution in the Hawaiian picture wing Drosophila. So for those of you who are unfamiliar with the picture wing Drosophila, they're a diverse adaptive radiation endemic to the Hawaiian Islands, and they contain approximately 120 described species. Thanks to a lot of dedicated past work, we know that they're very ecologically diverse, and we have a lot of information on this ecological diversity. So we know about their behavior, their morphology, their biogeography, as well as the different plant host substrates that they choose to breed in. In addition to being ecologically cool, they're genomically appealing because they have small genome sizes at about 200 megabases, and there's a large genome resource database that we can sort of utilize because they are so closely related to the model organism Drosophila melanogaster. The Drosophila genus colonized the Hawaiian Islands approximately 25 million years ago, and they diverged into two major groups. One being the Hawaiian Scaptomyza, which then went on to recolonize continental areas, and then the other Hawaiian Drosophila groups you see here. The picture wings, which I'll be focusing on today, diverged a little over 5 million years ago. And you can see here, so here's a Scaptomyza. It's one of the Hawaiian species. It's kind of small, what you traditionally think of as a Drosophila species. And here are the picture wings, and this size comparison is pretty much true to real life. So the Drosophila are these really large, ornate flies that have these beautifully colored wings with different patterns. So like I said, they've been ecologically well studied, and we know that they use about 34 out of 87 families of native flowering plants, in addition to ferns, sap fluxes, and even spider eggs. So they've really utilized the plant diversity here in the Hawaiian Islands in addition to some other substrates. And the way that this host-plant interaction works in the Drosophila, or in the picture-ring Drosophila, is unique. So what happens is that the males will go out into the environment and form a lek, so like a lek, like a bird lek, which is kind of interesting for a fly. And then the female will find the male lek, they'll mate, and then the female is the one that actually seeks out this host plant in the environment and chooses which host plant it will oviposit on. So this interaction, from what we know, is largely female driven. So what we wanted to do with this project for my master's thesis was kind of start looking into this host plant and fly interaction. So how is the fly choosing the different host plants in the environment if they have diversified across so many different plant species? And we could have looked at this in a couple of different ways. So the first, we could have taken this sort of more environmental approach. So looking at the different host plants. So asking questions like, is a fly choosing a host plant in the environment because it's very common? Or are the different host plants that the flies are choosing, do they have similar chemical makeups? Instead, we sort of took a more genetic genomic approach. And we wanted to ask, how are these flies genetically adapted to these different host plants? And so this pilot work is what I'll be talking about today. The species that I will focus on, the species that I'll be focusing on today are four of the Hawaiian picture wings. The first, some of you might recognize, it's Drosophila grimshawi. So this was the first Hawaiian picture wing to be sequenced. It was sequenced by the Drosophila 12 Genomes Consortia using Sanger sequencing, so it has a relatively complete and well-annotated genome. And the three species that we used de novo whole genome sequencing to look at were Drosophila ochraea, Drosophila sproti, and Drosophila murphyi. Whereas Drosophila grimshawi is a generalist species endemic to the Maui Nui complex over here, Drosophila ochraea, Drosophila sproti, and Drosophila murphyi are all considered specialist species endemic to the Big Island of Hawaii. Drosophila ochraea uses the native Hawaiian host plant EAEA, and Drosophila sproti and Drosophila murphyi are sister species that utilize the host plant Olapa. The outgroup that we'll be focusing on today is Scaptomyza flava. Scaptomyza flava, like I said before, the genus Scaptomyza arose here on the Hawaiian Islands, but this species is actually one of the species that went on to recolonize the mainland. So the outgroup that we'll be using today is diverged enough from the Hawaiian picture wings that we can get a good idea about positive selection and infer the genetic relationships, but not so far as Drosophila melanogaster that we're not really gathering any different information from it. So the main objectives of this project were to look at the genomic landscape changes across the picture wing phylogeny in comparison with the closely related Scaptomyza and continental Drosophila. And what this first objective, what we really wanted to do is just to we wanted to garner what the basic changes were, or how different the different picture-winged Drosophila genomes were. So are there a lot of genomic differences between these Drosophila, or are there relatively few? So just how similar are these genomes when we're just looking at basic genomic traits? And the second thing that we wanted to focus on was investigating positive selection across the genomes with attention to chemosensory genes, which may contribute to host plant preference. So chemosensory genes, which I'll go on to discuss a little bit more later, are thought to be important in this host-plant interaction between insect and host species. And they contain genes in the family, in the olfactory, gustatory, odorant-binding proteins, and glutamate receptor families. So diving into those results, the first thing that we wanted to correlate was repeat content. So repeats contain things like transposable elements and microsatellites, so both tandem and short interspersed repeats. And we wanted to see if there was a correlation between the percent of repeats in the genomes and the actual size of the genome. we wanted to look at this because repeats are often thought, especially transposable elements, to kind of increase the diversity across genomes because they'll hop around and change the position of genes as they move. And what we found was that there was a really significant correlation between genome size and repeat content. So the black dots that you'll see, those are all of the 29 Drosophila genomes that have been sequenced ever. The dot in red is the Scaptomyza, so Scaptomyza flava that we looked at. And then the picture wings are the dots in blue. So the picture wings mostly cluster down here with a small genome size and relatively low repeat content. But this one up here, that's Drosophila grimshawi. So Drosophila grimshawi is an outlier in this data set, and it could be because of one, it could be for a few reasons. It could truly have just a much higher repeat content than the three species that we sequenced. Or it also could be because it was sequenced using Sanger sequencing, which tends to kind of catch those repeats a little better than high throughput sequencing will. So looking more into that relationship, I know these numbers are kind of small for some of you in the back, but across the top here are different classes of those repeat elements. And what we can see from this, which gives us kind of a total percent repeats, is that grimshawi actually has three times as many repeats as our three Drosophila that were sequenced from Hawaii Island. And we thought that this relationship was kind of curious because Scaptomyza also had a high repeat level at about 30%, like Drosophila grimshawi, whereas Melanogaster had 22% repeats. So we looked farther, beyond the class level of transposable element classes into transposable element families. And what we found was that Scaptomyza flava has a huge diversity of repeat families represented across its genome. Grimshawi, however, doesn't really have this huge diversity of repeat families. It just has more representatives of a couple of repeat families that already exist in our other three picture wing Drosophila. So what could have happened is that the original colonizer of the Drosophila to the Hawaiian Islands could have had a repeat family similar to Scaptomyza flava, and the picture wings have subsequently lost these repetitive elements. Or Scaptomyza flava has experienced a lot of horizontal transfer of repeat elements once it went on to recolonize the mainland. The next thing that we looked at was genomic syntony. And the way that you can look at these graphs, so on the right side here is Drosophila melanogaster. You can see that there's kind of these like long, thick bands on the side. So those represent the different chromosomes. And then on the left here is each of the respective picture wings. So Sproti, Murphyi, Ocratia, and Grimshawi. And you can see, like I said earlier, Grimshawi was sequenced using Sanger sequencing, so its scaffolds are a little bit larger. So basically, the length of DNA that's in a single piece after we use de novo assembly. And what we found, if you can just look at these graphs, and the way that you read them is each line represents a gene going from one chromosome to another. If we would see a gene movement from different corresponding chromosomes, the line would, for example, go from here to a different color. So what you can see in these graphs is that genomic syntony has been completely conserved across the picture wing phylogeny. And there are some differences between the picture wing karyotype, or what their chromosomes look like, and Drosophila melanogaster. So the picture wings have X, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, whereas melanogaster has X, Y, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 in the picture wings is a highly reduced Y. So there are some differences, but genomic syntony across these species and between melanogaster is almost entirely conserved. What we can't view from these graphs, because we do have smaller pieces of DNA, are these chromosome changes that happen within chromosomes. So picture wings are known for chromosomal rearrangements, but inside each particular chromosome. And so we can't tell whether, for example, a gene hopped from one spot on a single chromosome to another spot on that same chromosome. So we're a little bit limited. So for the last part, I'll be going over the positive selection tests that we did. And these were grouped into two basic tests. So the first test we did, we used all of the genes in all of our species that we're looking at, so Scaptomyza flava and the four picture wing species. We pulled out one-to-one orthologs, so genes that look identical and are derived from the same ancestral species. And then we used branch site and site test models, which I'll explain very shortly. And then in test two, we just focused in, again, on those chemosensory gene families. So those are olfactory receptors, odorant binding proteins, gustatory receptors, and glutamate receptors. We kept all of the orthologs and paralogs here, so that means that we kept any gene in the event that there was a duplication. And we did that because it's known that chemosensory genes generally, they diversify by duplication, usually by the movement of transposable elements, which I discussed earlier. And again, we use the branch site and site test models. So first, looking at all genes, so all genes using one-to-one orthologs, and then each individual species. For this, we used a branch site test. And what a branch site test allows you to do is take a single species and ask, are there any genes under positive selection in this single species as compared to the other species in the phylogeny? We found 12 genes under selection across our four picture wings. So here's each of the four. And there was some overlap between Drosophila sprotii and Drosophila murphyi. This makes sense because Drosophila sprotii and Drosophila murphyi are sister species which utilize the same plant hosts. And most of the function of these genes was with protein transport and signaling. Obviously, for any positive selection analysis, when we're looking at the different functions of genes, we're really limited by the annotations that we have from melanogaster about those gene functions. So what was exciting is that cytochrome P450 was actually under selection when we looked at Drosophila grimshii. And cytochrome P450s function in insecticide resistance and plant toxin detoxification. So finally, something that had anything to do with a host-plant association kind of popped up here. And it actually wasn't one of the individual gene families that we were looking at, but it's interesting nonetheless. So this is all looking at all genes, so still those one-to-one orthologs, but using all of the picture wings. So instead of looking at each individual picture wing, we're looking at the branch that's leading to the picture wing, asking what was under selection when the picture wings diverged. We found 264 genes under selection. We found functions of these genes in chemosensory genes, P450s, as well as male-to-male aggression behavior and other aggression behaviors. So although this study wasn't in particular looking at anything about aggression or those types of behaviors, this is interesting for the picture wing clade because they're known for their kind of dynamic mating dances and fights that they'll have between different species. So this is definitely something to look into, and it makes sense for the adaptive radiation. But then the P450s popped up again, which made me really excited. So the last thing that we did was we looked just at those chemosensory genes. So this is the chemosensory genes using all orthologs and paralogs, so retaining any duplications that have happened. And we found three genes under selection after correction. All of these genes had function in olfactory receptors or odorant binding proteins. We didn't find any gustatory receptors or glutamate receptors under selection. And then lastly, looking at chemosensory gene gain and loss. So there's a hypothesis that there's more loss in specialist species because if you're a specialist species, you don't necessarily need to have a variety of genes to adapt to a variety of different plants. You only need a singular set of genes to adapt to the one plant you're going to overposit on. So we found more loss in specialist species corroborating this claim. Gain does not have as clear of a pattern, but net gain and loss does support this trend, with Drosophila grimshii, a specialist, having a net loss of 0. Drosophila ocratia, Drosophila sprotii, and murphyi had a loss of -6, -14, and -4 genes, respectively. I'm going to skip the summary because I'm running out of time, but hopefully you remember the entire talk because I know you're all listening really well. So thanks to everyone who has helped out with this project. It's been a tremendous effort. And I will take a question if I have any time. No. Okay.
Hi, my name is Lily Okonihi-Raida, and today I'll be presenting some of the research I've been working on for my thesis. So taro is a plant of high cultural value. Unfortunately, it is prone to taro leaf blight, which is caused by Phytophthora colocasei, which is why my research is evaluating the pathogenicity profiles of P. colocasei, or Phytophthora colocasei. So briefly, some of the things I'll be talking about is why the plant is such a culturally significant plant. Also, I'll be giving some background on what taro leaf blight is, some background information on Phytophthora colocasei, and I'll be talking about my current research. Taro is a plant of high cultural value because the story is told that taro came from the body of Haloa, who is said to be the older brother of all native Hawaiians. Taro is a symbol of family because Hawaiians are taught to care for Haloa as we would our older family members, and in return, Haloa takes care of us by providing us with food. With that said, taro is also a staple in the traditional native Hawaiian diet. One of the ways it's commonly eaten is in poi, which you can see here. And research has shown that maintaining the traditional Native Hawaiian diet can improve cholesterol levels, improve blood pressure, and improve cholesterol levels when it is compared to the modern Western diet. Taro leaf blight is the most significant taro disease known worldwide, and it causes these rapidly expanding necrotic lesions, which you can see here. And a plant that is infected with Phytophthora colocasia, it has taro leaf blight, will experience up to a 95% decrease in leaf area. And the decrease in photosynthetic tissue can cause a reduced corm size. Also, the disease can also cause the corms to rot. And it can be economically devastating for those who cultivate taro because the disease causes such a decline in taro yield. So as I said earlier, taro leaf blight is caused by Phytophthora colocasia, and it is a hemibiotropic oomycete plant pathogen, which means it's an organism that will infect living tissue and will continue to live in dead tissue. It is commonly spread through the wind when the sporangia are carried through the wind, and through the rain when the sporangia release oomycete or zoospores. And the pathogen thrives in humid conditions and temperatures that range between 20 and 28 degrees Celsius, making Hawaii an ideal place for the disease to thrive. Resistant taro has been identified, which is why a breeding program has been established to kind of combat the disease. And the program involves crossing Palawan taro, which is known to be highly resistant to taro leaf blight, and crossing Maui Lehua, which is known to be highly resistant or highly susceptible, and is also the variety that's commonly used to make poi. Some qualities the researchers look for when selecting offspring from the hybrid cross is having a high yield production, having resistance to pest and disease, and having a palatability that is comparable to Maui Lehua. Some previous studies that have looked at some of the offspring from the hybrid, from the crosses, used P. colocasia strain HBA1, which was originally isolated from Panaeva. And results from that showed that many of the offspring were resistant to HBA1. But upon further studies that used isolate HBE3 showed that the plants that were thought to be resistant were actually susceptible to the strain. And the same was for some of the plants that were resistant to HBE3 were susceptible to HPA1. This brought my thesis question, which was, are the fields Panaeva and Pipekeo pathogenetically homogeneous? In other words, will all isolates from the same field site yield the same results on disc assays? To do this study, I isolated multiple strains from Panaeva and Pipekeo. I got 12 strains from Pipekeo, which I named HBE4 through 15, and 9 strains from Panaeva, which I named HPA 2 through 9. I used disc assays, and what that involved was inducing zoosporulation and inoculating leaf samples with those zoospores from these isolates. And I put them on, so I cut my plant cultivars into discs and I got 50 zoospores and inoculated them onto the leaves. I incubated my assays for 4 days and I took the relative lesion size from the assays. So what the relative lesion size is the size of a lesion on one leaf in comparison to bunlong. And bunlong is known to be susceptible to taro leaf blight, so it's a positive control. And I analyzed the data using a Euclidean formula in R, and what that is it's a mathematical way of kind of plotting all my lesions onto an XY plot, and it'll make a heat map based on how close the plots are to each other. So from my Pipekeo isolates, I have 2 groups, and I also reanalyze the HPA 1 and 3 strains, or HPA 1 and HPE 3 strains, which you can see here. So HPE 3 and HPA 1 were significantly different from all the strains, and even within my PIPA-KL strains, HPA 1 and HPE 3 are also included into these. So this is one group, and then this is another. I also compared all the isolates with each other. So I compared HPA 1 and HPE 3 all, and as well as my HPE 4 through 9 and HPE 2 through 50. So, and then I have three groups here as well. And still, HPA 1 and HPE 3 were significantly different. So it can be determined that Planet Eva and PIPA-KL populations are not homogeneous, and isolates from the same field sites were significantly different than other fields, some of the strains that were found between field sites. Based on this research, it can be concluded that field sites are not homogeneous, or not pathogenically homogeneous. And this is significant for future research because when testing plants for susceptibility or resistance, it's important to test the plants against multiple strains of Phytophthora cohortensis. I'd like to thank my committee members, Mike Shintaku, John Awaya, and Jesse Ivan for their help throughout this project. I'd also like to thank National Science Foundation for granting me with a CREST grant, which helped fund this project, and the UATL Ag Lab and UATL Track Lab for their support throughout this project. Thank you. May I answer your questions? They were isolated a few years ago, so I think they're changing within culture. Yeah. So.
Yeah. They're evolving in the lab.
Yeah, actually, so then I did two trials, and even those trials were about 2 weeks apart, and even that was different. So if they change within 2 weeks, then a few years is.
Introduce you to that infectious stage of the Angiostrongylus cantonensis, the rat lungworm, looking at rainwater catchment issues in Hawaii, and then looking at my water studies and how each study led to the next study, looking at first could intermediate hosts shed the rat lungworm in water, confirming that they could, and then looking at could they pass through filter sizes and could they be viable in catchment tanks. And then the implications of those results and looking at the need for management. Could you get the slide on the right, this video here? So this is Angiostrongylus cantonensis, the rat lungworm. This is the first to third stage larvae. This picture here on the left is a tissue squash from an infected intermediate host. You can vaguely see the molt sheets that are retained when it is in the intermediate host, which would be the gastropod species, terrestrial and aquatic snails, some species. This is a third stage larvae that is in the video in acid. It's been in acid for 3 hours at the point in time that video was taken. And so that would be an infective larvae in that it would pass through the gut and be able to get into the bloodstream and cause meningitis in a person or in an animal that would not be the definitive host, which would be the rat. So angiostrongylosis is the disease caused by the rat lungworm. It can result in meningitis, encephalitis. Globally, it is the leading cause of eosinophilic meningitis. And Hawaii is the epicenter of this disease for the United States. So we had people say that they thought they maybe had gotten infected by catchment, which is where this study came from. My son got this disease, and I became the hotline for people calling, and a lot of people didn't know how they were infected, which really made me question what was going on. But in Hawaii, we have 30 to 60,000 people, and that's probably a very conservative estimate, using rainwater catchment for their primary water supply. Particularly Puna District, where we see a high incidence of this case, about 75% of Puna is on rainwater catchment. People definitely see slugs and snails crawling up and into catchment. Catchment tank cleaners find drowned slugs and snails in the tank. The rainwater catchment manual said it was unknown if the host, if the parasite could live outside of the intermediate host. If it could, it should be able to be stopped by a 20-micron filter. So my question was, can they live outside of the host? And right away, I found three papers that did say, indeed, yes, they could. And a very good paper by Richards and Merritt that showed a number of things. They can live in seawater and that type of thing. And Cheng and Alicata said, yes, they could infect rats, which means that we could be infected, basically. So looking at a recent study that we did, we were looking at human prevalence in the East Hawaii district. And of the people who thought they were infected by catchment, it was a pretty high rate. It was 22% of the population that thought they may have had this disease, thought they may have gotten it from catchment. So that was my question was, if a slug, a drowned slug or snail could release parasites, where in a water column would you find them? Thinking that the intake for your pipe, if you're on catchment, is generally toward the bottom of your catchment tank. So I designed a very simple study. I collected rainwater off of a roof with no gutters, trying to get the cleanest rainwater sample I could. I found Tan Parmerion martensi, a very effective host. This semi-slug in the top left corner runs about 75% infected. Collected them from an area of known infection, took tail snips to run qPCR to look for infection. We have primers that are very specific for acantonensis. Drowned them in a 50-mil tube of water, and then after they drowned, began to take samples. This first study was a 10-day sample. I took samples from the bottom, middle, and top of the water column, put them in a petri dish, and examined them by microscopy. After the fourth day, I saw a big drop of these coiled organisms that emerged into swimming worms. You can see on days 3 and 4 in the graph, that was when the drop happened. I had several hundred parasites drop out of a couple samples from drowned slugs. Indeed, the majority were found in the bottom of the water column. And at the end of 10 days, I still had quite a number of living worms. The Parmerium that I used in the study, the slugs, 100% of them were infected, and they all showed infection by qPCR. So we ran a second study, a 20-day study, to verify the results of the first study, and we increased the number of species used in the study. So I used 4 giant African snails, 2 of the leatherback slugs, 2 Cuban slugs, 3 of the Parmerium again, and then 1 flatworm that is shown to be a good it's predaceous and it can also carry the parasite. I again found that most of the parasites were in the bottom sample, but this time I had a vastly different experience. So I pulled samples again from the bottom, middle, and top, 5 mil samples, put them in a petri dish, added about 10 mils of rainwater, which I was also inspecting, and it never had any worms in it. The samples I pulled on days 2 and 3, or 1 and 2, I should say, and up to 3, I would find maybe 1 or 2 worms swimming in the dish when I pulled the sample. I set it in an incubator that was not turned on. When I examined it on days 5 to 7, that dish gradually began to build in numbers. And by day 5 to 7, I had 1,000 worms in the dish, and I was really unclear where they were coming from. I assumed they were coming out of tissue. This top picture has a video tube. Can you hit the video on that? So this is what I found. The first study was very nice. I had these coiled larvae all the same size fall out. I had this all of a sudden on days 5 to 7. Literally, I had hundreds of worms in a dish that I did not see when I first pulled the sample. I didn't know where they were coming from. We didn't know what they were. So we spent quite a bit of time trying to figure out what these guys were. I took a lot of pictures. They have retained molt sheets, as you would find in this particular species. We went up to Peabark and asked them for some help. I called Stanford and asked them for some help. This Q-shaped movement that you can see in some of them is a behavioral movement, so it is very indicative of rat lungworm. A number of my specimens that I used showed up positive by qPCR, negative by microscopy, or vice versa. And so we were really a little bit wondering what was going on. It was very hard to get individual worms or even small batches of worms to yield enough DNA for analysis. So we opened a can of worms, basically, and we didn't know what they were. But we assumed that some of them could be rat lungworm, and we wondered what they were, and again, whether they could go through a filter, because a filter study had never been done. A paper by Ash in 1970, looking at 35 individual third stage larvae, showed that the maximum width ranged from 23 to 34 microns, with an average at 26 microns. This is pretty close to a 20 micron filter, and we found that something should be done. So we designed a preliminary filter trial to see if they could pass through a 20 micron stainless sieve. So I prepared the specimens pretty much all through these trials. This time, however, I rinsed the specimens first to make sure these weren't external nematodes picked up from the soil. So we rinsed them, prepared them the same way. I had identical situation come. Some were coiled, some came out in these first studies and erupted into multiple dishes with multiple worms. So the ones that I collected, that the parasites that were yielded from these drowned slugs, I put on top of a 20 micron sieve that was suspended in a 1,000 mil beaker of water with rainwater covering the sieve, put the worms on top, and these little guys all made it through. Within an hour, I had multiple worms in the bottom of the dish. So we said, well, some of these guys can indeed come through. We held these worms to see how long they could live. I actually ran this study twice. We had worms alive at 53 and 56 days, and when I collected worms, and they were a couple hundred, we tissue ground them, figuring we might be able to get better DNA results, and indeed they did test positive for rat lungworm, both at 53 and at 56 days. So then I started to think about what I'd been seeing. I saw these coiled drop, and then I saw these worms that come out of nowhere that I still can't figure out why I can't see them in that initial sample. I know they're there. But I started to think, and I said, I think that the coiled worms are third stage larvae, and I think that the smaller worms are probably first and second stage larvae. So I again ran the study, and this time I set my, instead of collecting the rainwater off the roof, I just put a jar in the middle of the yard to make sure I wasn't getting any contaminants. I also used tap water in the study. I, instead of taking tissue snips from all of the slugs that I used, 10 of them I did take tissue snips from. 6 I left entirely whole to see if it was the damage that I was causing that was causing the dropout. So I had the same type of thing. I had the coiled ones drop out. I tested them on top of the sieve. They could not go through. I tested them with acid to see if they were infected stage, so we made an HCl pepsin mix that mimicked stomach acid. Those worms indeed could survive acid. They would live up to 3 hours. They could not go through the sieve. And at 21 days, I still had worms that, if I they kind of look lifeless. There might be a couple of them there, but if I added acid to the dish, they would kind of spring back to action again. So at 21 days, I had larvae that looked like they were potentially infective. The other larvae that emerged sort of seemingly out of nowhere were able to go through the sieve, but they were not able to survive acid. I took samples of both types of worms, again with tissue grinding. We were able to get positive hits. It generally seems about 25 worms or more are really what's needed to get a good PCR sample of these guys. So it made us really look at the whole issue of catchment, and we see that the state has a lot of work to do. This is really a big problem. Maintaining catchment systems is expensive, and it looks like it's really critical that we get on board with the maintenance that's required to keep waterborne diseases away. Agricultural filtering is really a big problem. I don't know how many farms that use ag water are filtering, and so that could be a way of infecting produce. We don't know anything about UV exposure. We just know that this is a problem, and it really, really emphasizes the need for control. And so this last year, part of my studies has been to design an integrated pest management project. I'm working with school garden projects. I have five school gardens that kind of represent the areas in Hawaii that we're seeing a lot of infection. These schools have been just great. This is a little bit of data that we've covered. We're using shelters as a way. Our greatest number of snails collected, of invasive slugs and snails collected, was surprisingly in Waimea, which has a huge infestation of European garden snails. We removed over 3,000 snails from that campus. Total, we removed over about 4,100 invasive slugs and snails from school gardens. And our shelter type capture rate, we have data on that. Generally, looking around is a really good way to reduce the population. So the greatest number collected were simply by searches. But we do see some good stats coming out of traps. Cardboard works pretty well. I just have a million people to thank. My advisor, Sue Jarvie, my degree committee, people that have helped us look at trying to identify this, my lab manager, and yes, thank you very much.
Aloha, my name is Louise Economy. I'm a TCBS student, and today I'm going to be presenting my project entitled Climate-Driven Shifts in Staphylococcus aureus in Hilo Bay. So most of us know that the anthropogenic emission of CO2 is resulting in global climate change. This is causing changes in rainfall and weather patterns across the globe, and predictions of change vary by location. As we can see in this map of precipitation patterns, the warmer colors are indicating drier conditions, and the cooler colors are indicating wetter condition projections. In Hawaii, predictions are uncertain, though many models are suggesting that we're going to see an increase in the number and the intensity of storms. Here is Tropical Storm Azelle and Julio coming for Hawaii in 2014. So though we're going to get an increase in storms, we're predicted to also get a decrease in precipitation overall. And this trend has already been observed. In this graphic here, you can see that the pink arrows are indicating percent decrease in mean annual rainfall. And these are trends that have been seen from 1913 to 2001. So the decreases in rainfall that are occurring and that are anticipated are going to result in reduced stream flow. And in fact, Hawaii's stream flow has been decreasing over the past 70 years. Here is a picture of Rainbow Falls under normal wet conditions, and then under the drier conditions in 2012. And changes in weather and rainfall are going to have many impacts on aquatic resources in Hawaii. And one of those impacts are the consequences of pathogen loading to coastal waters. One pathogen that is of concern in Hawaii is Staphylococcus aureus. Staph aureus is a bacteria that is known to live on human skin. It is estimated that two out of five people have staph on their skin at any given time. And it's an opportunistic pathogen in that, given the right conditions, it can cause disease. It can invade wounds and cause rashes, boils, and flesh-eating diseases. And in more severe cases, it can cause blood infections and more severe infections over the body. So though staph is associated with human skin, it is also being found in the community more and more, including in recreational waters and beaches. And the abundance of staph in these areas is presenting a risk to beachgoers. In a study on Oahu, it was found that beachgoers are 4 times more likely to develop staph aureus skin infections than a control group that did not go to the beach. And staph, as it is associated with skin, is believed to enter recreational waters through the removal of the bacteria from the human skin while swimming. However, recent studies suggest that the staph can enter coastal waters through watershed sources. Staph has been found in agricultural runoff, it's been found in stormwater, also in wastewater, so cesspool leaking into coastal waters could be a source. And evidence also suggests that it is present in wildlife and can persist in soils. And so though there has been many studies on human shedding as a source of staph to recreational waters, there has been limited investigation on watershed sources of staph and how these sources and the transport of staph into the waters will change under different climate conditions. So that is what I'm looking at in my project, and I have two research questions right now. And the first one is, how does staph vary with differing rainfall and stream flows? And by looking at this, we can assess risk for beachgoers under different climate conditions. My second question is, what are the main sources of staph that are impacted by rainfall? So to look at these questions, I'm doing a study in Hilo Bay. Hilo Bay has variable rainfall. It also has stream flow from the Wailuku River and the Wailoa River. There's a lot of groundwater discharge into the bay, as well as runoff from urban Hilo. And a lot of Hilo is on cesspools too, suggesting that cesspool leakage into the bay is occurring. I have been collecting water samples at 4 different locations within the bay. We have a station at the Wailuku River mouth, the Wailoa River mouth. We have a station that's more impacted by groundwater at Reeds Bay, and then we have a station at the water quality buoy. We are recording stream flow from the Wailuku River based on the USGS stream gauge. We're also getting rainfall data from the National Weather Service, and with each water sample, we're collecting water quality data. To count staph in the water samples, we're filtering them. We're plating the filters on a selective media. So here's an example of what a plate would look like. We're incubating these and allowing staph to grow. And this media only allows staph to grow, and if it allows anything else to grow, it colors it a different color. So all the purple colonies are staph. We're counting these colonies, and then to confirm that the colonies are staph, we are restreaking them and conducting coagulase tests. So I'm going to present some data that I've collected so far over 10 different sampling days. Here we have staph abundance. I'm comparing high flow and low flow of the Wailuku River across different stations. We did not see so far a significant difference between staph abundance in high versus low flow, though there does appear to be a trend with the stations that are closer to land, the Wailuku River, Wailoa River, and Reeds Bay, having higher staph abundance at higher flow, during higher flow conditions. And we also see that staph abundance during these high flow conditions is higher at the river mouth. This data suggests that staph abundance may be increased during high river flow conditions into the future. We have found a positive correlation between staph aureus abundance and rainfall. This is data from the Reeds Bay station. And this positive trend suggests that at higher rainfall, we're getting more staph into the bay. So these trends right now are suggesting that maybe staph aureus loads will present less of a risk to users in the bay under drier conditions. However, the risk may increase during intense storms, and storms are predicted to increase with climate change. For my second research question, looking at the different sources of staph, the different reservoirs of staph in the watershed, we haven't begun collecting direct measurements, but if we look at some of the relationships we see with water quality parameters and staph, we can get some clues as to what those important sources are. Here we have staph abundance and salinity, and we see that we have a negative significant relationship, suggesting and supporting the idea that staph is coming from land-based freshwater sources. So streams and stormwater might be a good place to look for staph. We also found a significant positive relationship between staph abundance and turbidity, and this may suggest that staph could be abundant in soils. And we also found a significant and positive relationship with staph abundance and fecal indicator bacteria. Here on the x-axis is Clostridium perfringens, which is a fecal indicator bacteria used by the Hawaii Department of Health to assess sewage pollution. And this positive trend suggests that staph may be coming from wastewater leakage into Hilo Bay. So we're planning to investigate soil and stream water in developed and undeveloped areas, also storm water and wastewater. And we want to look at which of these sources is more important. And by looking at this, we can make better predictions on how climate change will impact the transport of staph from these sources into the bay. So we're continuing to work on this project. I'm hoping to get more data to capture higher stream flow events to further investigate trends with staph abundance and stream flow. We're also gonna start looking at methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, which is the more dangerous and obviously antibiotic-resistant form of staph that is a growing health concern. So it will be interesting to see if the trends between staph aureus and the more virulent strain are the same. And then we're gonna test those sources of staph to see which ones are most important. And that way we can make better predictions about staph aureus transport to coastal waters with climate. And at the end of this project, we're hoping to inform and prepare the public for changes in staph aureus risks due to climate change. With that, I would like to say thank you to my mentor, Dr. Tracy Wigner. I'd also like to thank Dr. John Awaya and Aaron Strach, and then all of the people in the TCBS program and undergrads who have helped me with this project. I'd also like to thank the Haole Mauloa Foundation for funding me and the Pacific Island Climate Science Center. And with that, I will take any questions or comments.
Right. progression was when you didn't break it up into high and low?
So the graph was rainfall, and we didn't break it up into high and low rainfall. The high and low, so high river flow was 3.5 cubic meters per second, and low was 1.5 cubic meters per second. So anything higher than that would be high flow. Those limits are just based on prior studies that have compared high flow versus low flow.
Have you tried just looking at that as a continuous variable?
We have looked at it. We see the trend is there, but it's not statistically significant. And we look at it by station for statistical reasons, so we kind of get less points on there. So. Yes?
With the new ban on cesspools, do you think that's going to make the numbers change in the future?
Hopefully. we're going to look at the, we're actually going to test septic tank water. It's going to be hard to test cesspool, but we're going to test septic tank water. And if that does indeed turn out to be a big source, then the cesspool ban could definitely impact pathogen loading. Yeah, so they have found staph on pigs. What we were thinking as far as looking at that, we could possibly, there's been studies that looked at staph abundance in pig farms, and they see like high levels, and so we do have some pig farms in the Wailuku watershed. I don't think we have any plans to test pigs directly, but we were thinking of testing soils that are fenced versus soils that aren't fenced to look at that difference in the pig. Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you to all this morning's speakers. Just kind of tying in what Lynn was saying yesterday, Kay has been working on getting a bill through our state legislature to help fund the rat lungworm studies. It unfortunately died in Ways and Means this year, but talk to her today if you'd like to help out with that process. We're gonna break for lunch. We start again at 10 after 1. I think we have some leftovers from yesterday available out there, otherwise you're on your own. The silent auction will go until 1 today, so use this time during lunch to make your bids. And we'll see you back for the afternoon session.